Hello, I want to welcome you back to the podcast, How to Play the Game of College, where weekly we ask resource experts about strategies and best practices to help you as students and also as parents to navigate the post-secondary scene. I am so excited today to have my guest, Dr. Tyvi Small, who is at the University of Tennessee at Knoxville, and he serves as the Vice Chancellor for Diversity and Engagement at the university. I'm going to just tell you his title because he has so much going on, but I've cut enough more background. And if you can, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Again, I'm Tyvi Small. I serve as Vice Chancellor for Diversity and Engagement at UT Knoxville. In this role, I serve really as our campus's Chief Culture Officer and Chief Climate Officer. So access is a pretty big part of our mission, making sure that people from all backgrounds, all walks of life, have access to their state's land grant and flagship institution. And so part of my outreach and engagement responsibilities, I have an office that works with me that really ensures that we live out our land grant mission, which is to give every Tennessean an opportunity to access education at the University of Tennessee. So that is my role. I've been at the university for about 16 years. I spent my first 13 years here in the Haslam College of Business, where I headed diversity, talent management, and community relations. So that's a little bit about my UT background, a little bit about me personally, husband to my wife, my beautiful wife, Tammy. I'm a first-generation college student, so nobody in my family that had gone to college prior to me. And so really, as I thought about navigating higher ed, I felt like I was on my own, and I was really kind of building the plane as we were flying it, because we didn't have resources to refer back to. We didn't have people that we could really rely on other than mentors and people from my high school and from my school who really took interest in helping us navigate the system. So that's me in a nutshell.
Sounds good. Well, again, welcome to the podcast today.
I'm excited that you're doing this for our community. This is great work.
Yeah. And I like how you mentioned first generation college student. I did not know we had that in common. And so that was one of the main reasons I actually wrote the book, to really help all types of students to really act as post-secondary, right? When we look at some of the challenges that students face when they get to college campuses, can you maybe identify maybe two or three? I know you've been in post-secondary for a while now, right?
Absolutely.
And so looking at maybe two or three common challenges that you notice with students, and how maybe as students in high school, they can kind of prevent those challenges.
Right. So I'm actually going to take a different route. I'm going to talk about the hidden curriculum that most college campuses have. So we do a lot to get students here. We work with them. We help them navigate the process, the admissions process, financial aid. But when students get here, it's one thing to get students on campus.
Right.
Another thing to their success. And I think many times college campuses don't do enough at ensuring that once we get students here, that they're able to thrive and really be successful. And there's a hidden curriculum, right, that exists in many of our campuses that you don't know it until you know that you don't know it, right? And so accessing tutors, you know, in high school, you think, oh, you go to a tutor if you're behind, right? Or you only go to the professor's office if you're in trouble or you don't understand something. And so we have to sort of help folks understand, particularly those who were like me who were first generation, that these are all of the hidden tips and tricks of the trade that right. help students be successful, that many times we don't walk into our universities, our colleges knowing that. And so there's a massive hidden curriculum that we're trying to help uncover so that students know how to be successful once they get here. Because ultimately you go to college to graduate. So we got to do more than give you access, right? We have to enable your success.
Right.
How do we do that? So that's what I've seen. So if you look at it from the pre-collegiate piece right before enrollment, it's the stuff, right? How to apply to universities, what letters of recommendation means, what all of that process. But the other thing I'll say is that as we talk about kind of, you know, college is playing the game of college, you have to understand what the game is. You want to play the game. I think so many times we send students to four-year institutions because it's the thing to do. And we never sit down and talk to our students about what is it they want to accomplish? And then once we figure what they want to accomplish in life, then we can help guide them on the best path to get there. And that path might be coming straight to a university like University of Tennessee. It might be taking advantage of Tennessee Promise, right? Because around when I was in college, you know, with a mom raising two kids, probably would have said, listen, let's do Tennessee Promise for 2 years.
I know.
Last dollar scholarship, free tuition, and then you transfer to the university if we had known that, like if we had that verbiage. So I think there's a lot that we have to talk about to help students know what the game is
and true.
Help them understand how to play the game. And it might be different. It'll be different for every single student that comes across our desk, right? Tennessee Promise may be the best thing to do for some. It might be going straight to the university for others.
Right.
When your life circumstances, you know, there may be some students who don't want to go to football games, who don't, because they are focused on getting this degree, gain employment so that I can lift, and many times, like I myself, help lift my family out of poverty and help build some generational wealth. So it's those kinds of things, Dr. Boyd, that I think we need to really have some conversations about before we just say, you know, you get to go to college. Because there are 4,000 universities and there are thousands of other avenues and pathways that students can access, and we have to figure out that. So that kind of did answer your question, but I was trying. But I think we have to have a bigger dialogue before we start talking about this is what you do to go to college, right?
Right.
Well, yeah.
So true. And again, the first chapter of the book, right, I started it off with setting goals and right, beginning with the end in mind, because as you just stated, you have so many different types of institutions, which is chapter two, the different types of institutions and how to select the right college for you, right? And so we know that there's many different types of institutions and everything is not for everybody, right? And so we want to make sure that you know your goals, you have that path, begin with the end in mind, like what steps would it take me to get to that end point, which is key. And I like what you said, discovering a hidden agenda. If you have, just say, Lil Joe from Memphis, right? He's coming to University of Tennessee in Knoxville. Again, I agree. There's this hidden agenda, right? That, hey, we get students there, but it's not enough to just get them there. We want to make sure they're persistent and graduate. Who can Lil Joe go to for help or to even know about this agenda?
Well, it all depends. Campuses are different. The University of Tennessee Knoxville, we have every student gets a ball success team. So this is a group of people who are designed to follow Lil Joe, as you call them, through the process, right? And it's one of these things where it's multiple chances, multiple choices, right? So it might be the advisor, but if I don't catch you an advisor, maybe it's your academic coach. The academic coach doesn't get you. Maybe it's your one-stop counselor or your peer mentor. So this is a group of people who all talk to each other. They have access to the same information. So Joe may not go see his academic coach, but if Joe's showing up at his advising office, then the advisor can say, hey, Joe, make sure you go see your academic advisor or make sure you go see your peer coach. Because what we try to do is individualize this as much as we can, because we've tried to take the cookie cutter approach and hire it so much that we understand that depending, each individual student will have a set of individual needs, and how do we meet that need? And that's to personalize that experience as much as possible. Every student at the University of Tennessee takes strengths, right? Clifton strengths, because we want to have, many times we look at students who were in my background from a deficit mindset, right? What they don't have, what they didn't grow up with, what they didn't have access to. But our students come to us with so many strengths. So let's build on your strengths. Let's talk about what makes you uniquely you.
Right.
And then, you know, to help mitigate what your quote unquote deficits might be. And it's taken it because it builds self-confidence, it builds self-efficacy. This year, for the second year in a row, I think our number one strengths for our freshman class is restorative, right? They want to solve problems, right? They want to make things better. They want to tackle the tough issues. And knowing that about our students, we can then meet them where they are from a point of strength, right, versus a point of deficit. So that's what I think colleges need to do in order to make sure that they meet students where they are and that they can give them the self-efficacy to matriculate through, ultimately to graduation, right? So giving them those tools in their toolkit to be successful.
So true. And I like how you mentioned, you know, personalizing the experience, right? When it gets to a college campus, and then more importantly, make sure you take advantage of the services that are being offered, right? And so those things are key in really helping a student to, again, persist, and the ultimate goal is to graduate. As we talk about mentorship, right? One of the chapters I named in the book talks about mentorship and how important it is, not only in college, but just in life in general. Can you maybe give us an example of one of your mentors, and even looking at the college, you know, sector, how maybe that person is a first generation college student, kind of helped you to navigate that scene?
Yeah, so I had mentors throughout my life, and they were at many steps through life, right? So if I think about back to high school, right, those teachers that, you know, it sounds like a cliche, but it's so true that they saw something in me that I didn't see in myself. Right. And so they gave me guidance and direction and support. And once I got to college, Dr. Sam Wright was one of my biggest mentors. He recruited me to the University of South Florida. I'm originally from Florida. And he recruited me to USF and was a mentor. He helped guide, lead, and direct me through all of the challenges that I would face as an undergraduate. And he helped, when I talked about that hidden curriculum, he helped expose that, right? He helped get the right to the right people at the right place at the right times so that I could be successful. He was that person where we always knew we could call or email. I'm a little bit older than you all, so maybe email wasn't quite as popular. my first few undergraduate years, we could call, we could email, who would be there for us. And so, you know, mentors are needed. They're in my dissertation, I wrote about this idea of mentorship and sponsorship. Mentors and sponsors are absolutely great people to have in your life. So what's the difference? A mentor will say, hey, you need to walk through that door. That's where you need to go. A sponsor will say, you need to walk through that door. Let me grab your hand, walk you through that door, and let me use some of my social and cultural capital to get you an opportunity, right? So I think mentors and sponsors are both important, but sponsors maybe take it a little bit step further to ensure your success, but you need them all. And anybody, it could be your hall director, it can be your advisor, it could be your student organization advisor. Just find somebody on our campuses who have been there and done that and connect with them. And I will say mentorship is a two-way street. You just don't call your mentor when you miss, but take time to build a relationship, because it could be a long-lasting, long-standing relationship. That is beneficial on both sides.
So true. So true. And I love how you say it's a two-way street. You know, not a lot of times when, especially younger folks, like, hey, I'm going to wait for my mentor to call me, or I only might call when I'm later, right? So you have to, it's two-way. I love how you said that. And the last question I want to talk about, and this seems to be the ongoing conversation with many students, is the value of college.
I knew it.
So you got a student that says, hey, I'm graduating from high school. I got a job at the local Amazon. I'm making $18 an hour. They say I can make up to 30 if I work overtime. So I'm going to go get that job and just leave college. I don't want to even do this college thing because I'm going to still be broke. What would you say to those types of students?
I would say to each his own. There's no one right way to write your story. And college, for me, I think, was the great equalizer. I would say to any student, even if you don't go to a four-year institution like the University of Tennessee, try to get some post-secondary training or education, because that helps you build your toolkit, right? Because the world is changing now that everybody's talking about AI, for example. And so how do you get as much education as you can so that you can prepare yourself for the job you have today, but the job that will exist tomorrow that doesn't exist today? Right. So post-secondary education, I think it's important, because, you know, it helps you understand to how to be a learned person in our society. It helps you to critically think. It helps you to do all of those things for knowledge's sake. It also is a tool to help you gain financial freedom. Right. So as you talk about college education, I think I have this right, that someone who goes to college and gets a baccalaureate degree over their life will make about $2 million more just by getting the college degree. And so I do think if you're looking at it from an economic standpoint, right, you can increase your earning potential, particularly if you were someone like me who was first gen. Listen, I needed to make some money to help lift my family's financial situation up. And then the other thing is, it's this idea of brain versus brawn, right? Are you going to use your brain or are you going to use your brawn? But I will tell you, if you look at longevity, if you use brawn, more than likely you will tap out at a certain earning potential. Your body will only hold up. I mean, we are humans. Your body will only hold up for a certain amount of time. And so I need to make sure that even if you do work that, you know, is certainly, you know, utilizing your brawn, then at some point, maybe you need to think about how to repackage that so that you can use other skill sets. Because, you know, you can sling those packages when you're 18.
Right.
You get 38, 40, and 58. Yeah. So how do you put your toolkit? So as you mature, you can also mature your career options and opportunities. And so I would say do that, because I get it, right? Post-secondary in for everyone. But I also think that education and knowledge is for everyone.
Right.
You can still sharpen your tools. You can you can still put more tools in your toolkit in order to be successful. So is college for you? That's a decision that you have to make.
Right.
I will tell you, even if you think, hey, it's not for me, you can never go wrong with education. You can never go wrong with increasing your knowledge base. And so I that's what I would say to people who say, I don't know about college. It's an individual choice. But if you got to do it, I can guarantee you won't regret it.
So true. So true. And like you said, you know, a lot of times we only think about college as just a degree, right? College is so much more than just the classroom. You meet folks, you have fraternity brothers, learn how to network, right? Those soft skills that we talk about. And so like you said, hey, really look at a program that's for you, and, you know, look at how you can custom design it. Now there's so many options. You have six week certificates. You have 6 months, 9 months. You can go work and then onboard right back and not lose a credit. So there's so many different options that students and parents, if they're looking at college, can really take advantage of. So thank you for that. As we close out, I mentioned earlier, we talk about students, how to choose the correct institution, right? Campus tours, campus visits. University of Tennessee, Knoxville. Why should a student look to go, or maybe look at some of the benefits of attending a four-year institution, one of the largest in the state, right?
So I won't say UT per se. What I will say is, if you can, and there are a lot of community groups that help you do that. I serve with the Knoxville Area Urban League. And so we have a group of students called the National Achievers, and we take them on college tours and we take them on college visits and all of that stuff. I would say if you can, get connected in your community, because I think when you get ready to apply for colleges, they're going to look at your resume, and we're going to look at what you're involved in. You're going to need recommendation letters. And I think the more that you can get involved, that's where scholarships are going to come from. So the more that you can do that, I think the better. I think when you visit the universities, talk to the people, find out what is important to them, because how they treat you as a prospective student will more than likely how they treat you as a student. So I want to where you feel comfortable, where you feel like you can bring your authentic self, where all of your idiosyncrasies, you know, you feel like you can bring them to campus and you can thrive in those environments. And so college, so it's more than, you know, looking at, you know, the football team and the, you know, and if they have the major, of course, that's all important. But also think about how you feel when you're on that campus. Think about if you can bring your authentic self to that place. I would also say look at other opportunities, right? Look at graduation rates. Do students graduate? Look at the support services that they offer. So there's a lot of things that go into this process other than what we tell you on the tour. Ask some questions. Get with counselors, mentors to figure out what are the questions we need to ask. Are students graduating in 4 and 5 years? Are there scholarship opportunities beyond the first tier? What is all the things that are important to me look like on this campus? This is like, you know, selecting a spouse, right? You got to do work, right? Or, you know, you got to do due diligence. You got to ask the right questions.
Oh, because true.
You're going to spend 4 years and how many other thousands of dollars at that place. You want to make sure that it's a place where you feel like you can thrive, that you feel that you can be comfortable.
Right.
Place wants me, and it wants me because of who I authentically am. That's right. What I was. And you feel it. Sometimes you'll just know. You'll go somewhere. Oh, yeah, this is where I need to be.
So true. So true. Yes. Thank you so much, Dr. Small. You dropped some major jewels today. So I'm sure students and parents especially are out there taking notes. And so again, we will post your LinkedIn information and some just information about you doing the podcast. So if folks want to follow you or they have additional questions, they hopefully can
reach out. Please reach out.
Thank you for that. Thank you. And again, thank you for being on the podcast today. Viewers, make sure you tune in weekly. We're going to be having some dynamic interviews just like we just had. Also, make sure you go to my website at www.drshawnboyd.com. Hopefully by now, you have a copy of How to Play the Game of College. But if not, you can pick up your copy on my website. Again, thank you for tuning in. I look forward to seeing you all on next week. Thank you.
Thank you all.